you a happy Mother's Day today. If you have been in worship the last several weeks or been reading our emails, you may already know this, but we are doing a fairly extensive survey, and I just want to say, the last several years in this church, there have been a lot of surveys done, and I have all of the information from those surveys, which are going to be also used. This survey is particularly relevant right now because it is kind of to gauge where we are at right now after this over a year of pandemic, to kind of give us an opportunity to rethink the way maybe things have been structured, ministries we've offered here, mission work that we've done together. There may be some new areas that need to be addressed, and maybe some that have become less relevant. So I would encourage you to do that. We actually have hard copies available today that we'll be passing out as you leave. I told Valerie we are not passing them out before the sermon because I want you to listen to my sermon this morning. But we will be passing them out at the, whatever you call it, the back of the church or the front of the church, depending on whether you're inside or outside. And we also, tomorrow, will be emailing to all our whole congregation a version that you can print off and fill out and bring in or mail in, or in addition, one that you can save to your computer and fill in electronically and then save it and email it back to us. So there will be two different versions that will be emailed out tomorrow. We want as much feedback as we can get as we begin to discern what our new normal will look like, and it may just be it'll look like our old normal, but it may not. So I would just really encourage you to take the time to fill in the answers, be thoughtful about your responses, be thinking about where you believe God is calling this church.
us unconditionally, just exactly the way we are, and they take care of us and give us everything. So I thought it'd be fun to look out there and see how many mothers you think we have. Mothers, would you stand up? Give your mom a kiss, this kind of kiss. And then I thought, you might want a kiss too, right? So when you go to sit down again, be sure and get a kiss for your mom and a kiss for yourself and get a card, okay? The thing about moms are that they're just the people that love you so much. So they might be your mom, or they might be your grandmother, or they might be a really close family friend. It's just someone who loves you a lot, and that's who we're going to honor today, okay? Okay, anyway, let's pray and thank God for our lives, okay? Are you with us?
Dear Lord,
we're so happy that you sent us here.
Lord,
that you sent those lovely ladies to take care of us, and to love us, and we are going to appreciate them every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Back to you in your room, says my brother.
Thank you. majestic. If you would stand and join me in singing our doxology.
Follow me. Peter turned and saw the disciples. saw him, he said to Jesus, Lord, what about him? Jesus said to him, if it is my will that he remain until I come, what is that to you? Follow me. So the rumor spread in the community that this disciple would not die. Yet Jesus did not say to him that he would not die, but if it is my will that he remain until I come, what is that to you? This is the disciple who has testified to these things and has written them, and we know that his testimony is true. May God add a blessing to the reading of this holy gospel. Thanks be to God. So we are, I think, in week four or five of our sermon series that we're calling Arise, Reclaiming Our Own Post-Pandemic Resurrection. And so we've talked about the Emmaus journey when the disciples recognized Jesus in the breaking of the bread, and talked about how God never leaves us, even when we're not there, that he's there, he is there. We talked about when Jesus appeared to the disciples in the upper room, and the scripture told us that in their joy they were unbelieving. And we talked about what it means to believe even when it seems too good to be true, which is really the heart of Christianity at its core. Last week we talked about doubting Thomas and talked about facing our doubts because it is part of the journey to reclaim our true belief that Jesus has risen. If we never ask the question, could this have really happened? Do I really believe this? Then all we've done is just accepted what has been told us, and we haven't made that faith our own. And today, we look at this story of Peter, this breakfast on the beach story. And I mean, there's parts of it that I think this would be a really good scripture for Father's Day, because they're out fishing and, you know, laying around with the boat without clothes on, and then coming in and cooking fish on a fire. That sounds very Father's Day-ish. But I think, actually, as it turns out, it is a fairly appropriate scripture for Mother's Day, but really for all of us. So we look at the scripture, and we're looking at our need to forgive ourselves. And part of the reason we're doing this series is because the pandemic has wreaked havoc in our lives. It has touched really every area of our lives in ways that would have been incomprehensible, I think, 2 years ago. And I think a lot of us are walking around in a sort of tension, waiting for the other shoe to drop. Especially when we see that, you know, things in Denton County are really progressing really well regarding COVID. India, not so much. I have a daughter who teaches in India, and she made it home about a week before they closed everything in India. And it's horrific what is happening there. She's in contact with the teachers in the school where she teaches, and so we can consider ourselves blessed. But I think God wants us to arise, to wake up, to reclaim a post-pandemic resurrection for this church, to look and see what it is God is calling us to in this church, but also in our lives. There are things, I think, that may never be the same. My daughter had gone to Walmart the other day, and she got there at 10 minutes to 7, and she texted me, she said, Walmart doesn't open until 7 o'clock. And I said, yeah, I don't know if they'll ever go back to 24-hour service. This has been pretty nice for them to have time to fill the shelves. And, you know, for those of us who like the early morning Starbucks or things like that, you know, having things closed during the early hours of the morning hasn't been appreciated. But I think that it is time for us to begin making steps forward in allowing God to move in our lives and open up areas that we have closed off. something different. And they also had to be raised to something different because Jesus was going to leave them and leave them in charge of the things that he had done. And, you know, Jesus had the whole divine thing going for him, and the disciples were merely humans. And part of that process was to forgive themselves for not being who they thought they were, not being who they claimed they were. You may remember that just days before, and actually the evening that Jesus was arrested, just days before he was crucified, Peter had said to Jesus, "I will follow you to the ends of the earth, and in fact, I would die for you." But when it came right down to it, he denied him three times. And in my childhood, when I heard this story preached about Jesus addressing Peter on the beach, I was told this was God's way of redeeming Peter, that he denied him three times and now he gets to say he loved him three times. That was before I went to seminary and learned Greek. And some of you may already know this, you may have had this preached in a post-Easter sermon at some time. But in the Greek, it's a very different message. And I think one that is liberating for all of us who are not perfect. You know, all of us have mothers. How many of you are perfect? None of us. So Jesus says to Peter, "Peter, do you agape me?" Now the word, you know, the Greek language is very precise. Hebrew is very broad, and every Hebrew word carries about 20 meanings, and one of them is more prominent than the others, but there are undertones of all of the others. That's what I love about Hebrew, is there are all of these innuendos that go into every single word. And that's lost when we translate it in English. Greek is very precise. So there are very specific words. We may have one word that means all these things in English. Greek has lots of different words. And love is one of those. They have brotherly love. They have love of your children. Kind of maternal love. They have collegial love. They have agape, which is sacrificial love. So Jesus says to Peter, "Do you agape me? Do you love me sacrificially?" Which was basically what he claimed just days before he was crucified. "I would even die for you." Well, what is he going to say? Now, when you read it in English, he says, "Yes, Lord, you know I love you." But that isn't what it says, actually, in the Greek. There is no affirmative yes. We put that in the English. It is, "Lord, you know I phileo you. You know I love you like a brother." That word comes, that's where the word Philadelphia comes from. The land of brotherly love. It's to love you like a comrade. It's the kind of word that brother is, the kind of that we are brothers, that kind of military word that we use for our comrades who are in the same battle with us. And Jesus replies to him to feed his lambs. But then he asks him a second time, "Peter, do you agape me?" "Lord, you know I follow you." And he says, "Feed my sheep." And the third time, you're reading in the Greek, this is what it says, the third time Jesus asked, "Peter, do you follow me?" And it said that Peter was irritated that the third time he asked, "Peter, do you follow me?" He was irritated because he changed the question. The interesting thing for me in all of this, and you know, I think sometimes that we have to do a disservice when we don't dig deep enough to understand the meaning of the Hebrew and Greek words, because there is this profound human what, this is who I am. This is what being perfect in love looks like. Are you there? And we have to say, no, Lord, you know I'm over here. But in the end, God always meets us where we are. That there is this kind of process we go through where we see our failings, we see the areas that we need to do better, but that God offers us all of this grace in the end, that where we are is okay. We are not called to be perfect. We are called to allow God to perfect us in love. We are called to be in a process of being shown what being perfect in love looks like, so that we can see how far we have to go, so that the journey will be a journey of humility for us. Happened for Thomas, happened for Peter, for all of us who are called to go out and proclaim the good news of the gospel. We're called to this place first of humility, because otherwise all we do is put ourselves up here and scold everyone who's not where we are. So one of the reasons I think that this is really an appropriate scripture for Mother's Day is because I don't think there's a larger group of people who on a daily basis feel like they did not live up to what they are supposed to be. Because our culture, our society has these unattainable goals or unattainable benchmark for what women should be. I remember when I was in my very first appointment at Cooper Creek, United Methodist Church on Mango, little house in the brick church, parked up under the trees, and we were having a Bible study or something one day, and it was all, I was with a whole group of women, and they had just spent about 20 minutes talking about all of the previous pastors and their wives. I was the first woman pastor there. And they looked at me and they said, so, what was it that made you feel like you wanted to be a pastor? And I said, oh, that's easy. I'm not a good enough housekeeper to be a pastor's wife. And they all laughed. But, you know, I sort of feel like my house are there to lower the bar so all women everywhere can feel better about themselves. So, happy Mother's Day, that's my gift to you. But I think all of us during this pandemic have had that Peter experience where we didn't live into who we thought we were. And maybe it was just being irritable with our family, being demanding, complaining about, with all the gifts God has bestowed on us, to complain, I want my chips and salsa, I want to go out and eat in a Mexican restaurant, whatever it was that we lost our patience, we lost our joy, all of those fruits of the Spirit that God has worked to grow inside of us. That for all of us, I think there were times when we did not live into who we believed we were. But I think that we are called to forgive ourselves for that. That is part of the experience of being Christian that God calls us to be confronted with the reality of our own humanness. That we get scared, we get selfish, we kind of get complacent and lazy and grumbly and don't always portray Christ in the way we respond to other people. But God is saying to us, do you agape me? Well, it's who I want to be. I want to agape. That's the person I want to be. I want to be the person who would sacrifice my life for God. Am I there? I hope so. But honestly, I won't know until I'm confronted with a situation where I have to make that choice. In the end, I hope that is where I will be in God offers us forgiveness without boundaries. God offers us grace without boundaries. And we only recognize the value of that when we see into our own selves, the people that we truly are, and see the image of who God is calling us to be, perfected in love and grace. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give thanks to you this day for all of the women in our lives, for the way that you have allowed them to speak love into our lives. We give you thanks for the place, wherever it is, that you are calling this church. We ask that you would help us to discern what that might be. If there are needs now that weren't here before that haven't been addressed, Lord, we just give it all to you. And we ask that in the midst of our imperfection, that you would bestow grace upon us, that we might be able to forgive ourselves and forgive one another and move forward in perfection. In this life, we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. And now we come to that time, our worship service, where we have communion. And if you join me in this liturgy. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right, and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through the prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate the sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. You delivered us from slavery to sin and death. Make with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, you promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread. He gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. Gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on all of these gifts, the bread and the juice, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Now we would invite you now to take the bread and the juice, the body of Christ broken for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you. the importance of motherhood among us. We first give thanks that you are a loving parent to us all. From your being, all life was born, and in your bosom, all creation is nurtured. You have formed us in your image as your children, and gathered us together as a brood under your wing. You have united us as kindred members of one human family, and we are grateful to be your offspring together. Today, we celebrate your divine love, reflected in human expressions of motherhood. We give you thanks for the mothers among us, and ask that you strengthen them in their daily tasks. Grant them wisdom in the lessons they teach, patience in the discipline they foster, and persistence in their promotion of decency and compassion, both by word and example. May they be given the honor and thanks they deserve, but often do not receive. We thank you for all motherly figures, grandmothers, aunts, sisters, wives, stepmothers, foster mothers, guardians, babysitters, teachers, healthcare providers, neighbors, friends, loved ones, and many others who practice self-sacrifice and embody compassion to all who are privileged to be in their influence. Grant them vigor to carry on their work and the satisfaction that the holy privilege of their task affords. We acknowledge to you, O God, that even amid our grateful celebration, many of us come with restless spirits, reluctant to name the difficulties of this day. For some, this day brings the sorrowful awareness of their own inability to conceive biological children. Draw your tender spirit near their feelings of self-betrayal, impotence, and grief, and remind them that those who struggle with infertility have always shared a special place in your heart. We pray for those who have suffered miscarriages, those fatigued by fertility treatments, and those struggling through the process of adoption. May they remember that in your power and through your church, they can still leave a lasting legacy beyond themselves. For some, this day is marked by loneliness and grief, as they spend this Mother's Day as a widower, an orphan, or a parent who has lost a child. To those who today live in the wake of the death of a loved one, grant glimpses of the resurrection. Bring them to a steady restoration of their broken hearts. Allow them to live into their future with hope, and empower them to carry out the legacy of lessons instilled within them. For some, this day that surfaces ongoing tensions that exist within our personal relationships and family dynamics. We ask for healing from the wounds of our past, a path of forgiveness for wrongs both experienced and committed, and the rebuilding of trust forged in honesty, authenticity, and love. We give you thanks for the wide spectrum of motherhood represented among us today. New mothers and young mothers whose children are in the most tender years, mothers of grown children who transition into empty nests and a new chapter of self-discovery, mothers and grandmothers of advanced years whose twilight of life is marked by frailty of body but a potency of spirit. Theirs is a cumulative reminder that though our lives are marked by transition and change, your nurture and affection for all your children remains the same. Therefore, remind us to live with a childlike faith, curious to every wondrous mystery, attentive to your every instruction, obedient to your every command, and willing to share with every one of your children. We give you thanks, O God, who is a loving parent to us all, and in whose name we pray. And now we pray together the prayer that your Son Jesus.